Welcome. My name is Clark Chilson, and I'm a faculty member here in the Department of Religious Studies at the University of Pittsburgh. And I'm very honored and feel very fortunate that Director Soda Kazuhiro was able to make time out of his busy schedule to come and show three of his films here at the University of Pittsburgh and to have this lecture, which I think is a tremendous opportunity to learn from a Peabody Award-winning filmmaker how he makes films. And they have an hour and a half on how he does that. So if you would first help me welcome him, and then I'll give you a an overview of what's going to happen over the next 2 hours. So first. Two important things to let you know, as you hopefully noticed, there's food in the back. We're going to take a break at 12:30 for the food, and then after about a 10-minute break, we're going to have a Q&A session. That's the first thing. The second thing, for those of you who arrived in the past 3 or 4 minutes, I want you to know that there's a microphone up here. It's an ambient microphone, which will be great during the Q&A session, but it will also pick up any whispering you may have with the person sitting next to you. So you can think of this as the NSA being in the room. Anything you say will be recorded for perpetuity. Okay. So with that warning in mind, I will now turn the floor over to Director Soda. Thank you.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you for coming. My name is Kazuhiro Soda, and I thank you for having this, opportunity. Thank you, Clark-san, to have me give me this opportunity. I make films, mostly documentaries, and when I make documentaries, I call my films observational series or observational films, and I'd like to explain and show how I make my observational documentaries or how I approach documentaries in general. And this is the list of films I have made so far. Campaign is a film about a political candidate. A friend of mine from college decided to run for a seat in Kawasaki, Japan. So I decided to follow his endeavor and campaign. That was my first film. And then I shot Mental, which we showed last night. It's about people with mental illness, patients. I tried to depict the world of patients. I focused only one small clinic in Okayama, Japan. And third one is called Peace, but I didn't name it number three because I felt it was a very special film, which will be shown actually at 2 o'clock today. This film is about my parents-in-law and also my father-in-law's stray cats he's feeding. But it's about, it's very hard to explain. That's why it's special to me, but it's called Peace. And theater observational series number 3 and 4 is Theater 1 and 2. It's about playwright and theater director Oriza Hirata. He is one of the prominent major playwrights who kind of changed the game of theater in Japan. And he also has his own theater company, so I decided to focus on him and also his company as a whole. And I made two 3-hour documentary about them. So altogether it's like 5 hours and 42 minutes. It's a very long film. Next one is called Campaign 2. It's a sequel to Campaign. the guy who ran for campaign one, he was backed by this political party. It's called the LDP. It's the most powerful party of Japan. It stands for Liberal Democratic Party, but they are not very liberal or democratic. But anyway, he was picked by this party to run for the office. But campaign two was a total different film because it was shot in 2011, right after tsunami nuclear disaster. He was not a politician anymore, but he decided to run again without any backing, political party backing, because he wanted to appeal to the public the message of anti-nuclear issues. And so that's the campaign two. And the latest I just completed, it's called Oyster Factory. And guess what? It's about Oyster Factory in Japan. So these are the films I've been making. And the observational method is kind of connected to my personal personal life. I came up with this method and approach because of my personal background. So I wanted to briefly explain what's my background. Oh, and by the way, if you have any questions, please raise your hand and I'll try to, you know, answer at any time. And I was born in Japan in 1970, and since 1989, I joined Tokyo University and I studied religious studies. And 1993, I moved to New York to study filmmaking. And so I joined the School of Visual Arts I learned about making fiction films. I was not interested in documentaries at all. I didn't even take a class, single class about documentary. I thought I was going to be a fiction filmmaker. And then I graduated, and I accidentally joined a company which specializes in documentary filmmaking. It was a small company. I thought I was just making my living. I prepare for something else. But as soon as I joined this company and started making documentaries, I was kind of hooked. That's why I'm still doing documentaries. This company was making TV shows for NHK. NHK is a public network in Japan, but the company is based in New York. So my assignment was to make documentaries about America or New York. And then they were shown in Japan. But gradually I was frustrated to make TV documentaries because there are many restrictions in terms of how you make it and also the style of documentaries they want us to make. For example, for TV, you always have to do a lot of research before you shoot. For example, if you want to make a documentary about mental illness, you usually have to do a lot of research beforehand, and you pick and choose which hospital or which patient or which doctor I should focus on, right? And we usually have to go meet these subjects or candidates and find out what they're doing, and write synopsis and also write scripts, pretty detailed ones, like shot lists. You need to write shot lists, and also you need to write narration beforehand, And also, you need to know who's going to speak what. And you even prepare ending too, like how you end the film or program. And when you prepare the script, you discuss it with the producers, and producers give you approval, and then you finally you are allowed to shoot, right? So before shooting, you already have a script which is approved by layers of people, like this bureaucracy. So what's happening is if you shoot like that, what's interesting is usually you see something totally different from the script. The reality is much richer, I mean, than what you think. You know, script is just in your head, right? And if you go out and shoot, you see something totally different. And so you want to capture that, right? Then if you capture that and come back to the editing room, producers complain. Why you didn't follow the script? I gave you approval because we have the script. And the worst thing is that because you have bureaucracy of approval process, my immediate bosses become like in limbo, because you know he also was responsible to talk to his superior. So to prepare a script beforehand has a lot of anti-documentary kind of thing, but it's a system not to fail, right? I mean, for a company or for a TV station, they want to know what kind of project they are dealing with, or they want to know what kind of project they are putting money into. So it's kind of inevitable to have scripts, but it also kills documentaries. It's a dilemma. So I was always wondering, why do we need this in a script? And so I got very frustrated. Also, for the TV documentaries, at least for NHK, I was always required to write narration, explain everything. The slogan is, you have to explain everything so that a middle schooler could understand. And that was a slogan. So I have to explain everything, put in narrations, and also put in music. When you have a sad scene, you put sad music. But for me, it was, I mean, I felt, why do we need to do that? I mean, audience is not that stupid. So I was kind of getting frustrated when I was working as a TV director. It was fascinating at first, but gradually I had some sort of frustrations. So when I was laid off in 2004 because of the financial crisis of the company, I decided to set up my own company and started my own documentaries, which is the observational films. And when I say observation, I have two meanings. One is, I myself, as a filmmaker, try to observe the world in front of me and make a film according to my observation. It's just like I said, I was fed up with making documentaries based on scripts, well, based on preconceived ideas, preconceptions. I wanted to be free from that and just get in touch with the world in a direct way. I didn't want anything to get in between me and the world. So I decided, okay, I should just look carefully and listen carefully about what I see and hear, and make a documentary out of my observation. Well, I should try to learn from the reality. So that's one meaning of observation. And another meaning is that I want the audience to observe what they see. I want the audience to, I don't want to tell the audience what to see, or what to hear, and what to think, or how to feel. So I wanted to get rid of all the elements which might obstruct their observation. So that's why I decided not to use any music or narration, or even titles to explain who's who. If you saw Mental last night, you probably noticed that I didn't even title Dr. Yamamoto the protagonist. In a regular documentary, you usually say, you know, Dr. Yamamoto, 7 years old, or head of the clinic, or whatever, which is obvious if you are looking at it. But you just have to do it. The rule tells you to do it. But I felt it was not necessary. These are the two meanings of observation. So I came up with the 10 commandments of observation of filmmaking. Number one is no research. As I explained, you know, if you do research and gain knowledge, you try to shoot, you are kind of forced to try to shoot whatever you know already. Like, probably if you are doing study too, I mean, probably same thing might happen. Sometimes knowledge is useful, but sometimes it obstructs your observation, and it kind of interfere with your perception. If you have a preconception by doing the research, sometimes it's not so good. So I decided no research. It's not because I'm lazy. Maybe I'm lazy, but I decided. I made a conscious decision not to do any research beforehand. And number two, no meetings with subjects. I decided to have no discussion about the scenes or about the film I'm going to make with the characters. I need to get permission to shoot, but as soon as they give me permission, I start rolling the camera. I explain to them that I don't know what kind of film it's going to be, which is my honest feeling. Because I don't know. But I'm interested in you. Can I make a film about you? And usually they are happy to do that, accept my offer. So, no meetings with subjects. And number three is no scripts. It's a self-explanatory. I don't want to write any scripts. And number four is shoot alone. Because I don't have any plans, I don't make any plans. I need to be very flexible, right? If I have a crew of, let's say, five people, I need to kind of, not only I cannot follow my instinct 100%, even if I want to follow my instinct of shooting, let's say, maybe I should shoot tomorrow too, or I should shoot here or there. If I have a crew of five, I need to also consult their schedule too, or how they feel. So it kind of becomes more complicated. So basically, I decided to shoot alone, roll the camera myself, and also record the sound. And digital revolution kind of make it possible now. It used to be impossible. I mean, if you are shooting 16, it's impossible to shoot alone. But now you can. So I take the advantage of doing that. There are some exceptions. Sometimes my wife, Kyoko, she's also a producer, comes to help me. But she doesn't deal with any technical aspects. So yeah, I shoot alone, or possibly with my wife. And this is how I shoot. You know, I have a microphone on top of the camera, and mostly handheld, because I need to be very, I don't know, I need to move around and adjust my camera position, and so I need to be very flexible. But I also put some lavalier ear to sub characters which might speak the most in the scene. But sometimes that's impossible, so in that case I try to only pick up with the microphone. And this one is also from Mental. Just like you see, I often do not look at the camera or the monitor. I try to listen to the character, because that becomes more, I mean, it becomes more, it's important to make eye contacts. And number five, shoot as long as possible. This is not necessarily the length of the days or period. It's more like about the scene. For example, when I was making documentaries for TV, let's say you are shooting a meeting, which lasts for about 1 hour. Film crew often just go there and shoot only 10 minutes, because it's enough. You are supposed to put narration, so you don't have to pick up all the sound bites. You usually shoot only the first 10 minutes, having like long shot, maybe some close-ups, various people's close-ups, and also maybe some papers on the table. And if you have some catchy sound bites, you can construct the meeting. Even if you shoot only 10 minutes, you can pretend you shot the whole thing, and you put narration. And that's possible when you have narrations. But I cannot rely on narration, right? I cannot rely on explanation. So, or I'm forced to record everything and observe everything and see what happens. So yeah, shoot as long as possible. If the meeting is 1 hour, I need to shoot 1 hour. And that's the rule for me. So sometimes, for example, in campaign, there are many scenes where volunteers for the campaign just talk about whatever, like, you know, which goes on for 2 hours or 3 hours. But when I decide to shoot that, I try to shoot everything, which is pain in the ass sometimes, but it makes you tired, but that's the only approach. That's the only way you can get the full depth of the gathering. And number six, cover small areas deeply. because of the way I do, I cannot cover many different aspects. It's impossible. You need to kind of limit yourself to a certain area or certain people and focus and go deeper. With the campaign, I only focused on one candidate. I didn't really cover other candidates. You feel tempted to cover everybody, but I didn't do that, because if I did that, I would probably end up doing nothing, actually, covering nothing. You feel like you cover everything, but you didn't really cover anything. So I usually decide to focus on very small area, very small group of people. Mental too, you know, mental was only about this very small mental clinic. I could have covered like different hospitals or different like experts or whatever, but I didn't do that because I wanted to kind of focus on the small area and use it as a microcosmos. And you try to find some structures in this small world, because I believe some kind of structure, like it's like a how do you say it? It's like the same shape of the world is kind of within, how do you say that in
like
English?
Like Russian dolls or a box within a box.
Right, exactly. Yeah, that's how I see it. If you look close enough to one small area, you usually find the larger world in it. Because I don't know, that's the way I think, you know, how our world is kind of built in. I don't know, but that's how I feel. So usually you could find the structure which reflects the larger world. So even if you're focusing on a small area, you are actually looking at a much broader thing. For example, in the Oyster Factory, my brand new film, I try to focus on this very small oyster factory in Japan. And then when I was observing it, I thought I was making a documentary about just simply an oyster factory. But then when I was seeing it, shooting it, I noticed on the calendar, it said, November 9th, China is coming. What does it mean? China is coming. And I wondered. And then I started to realize that they were so short of people. The town is declining. The population is declining and rapidly aging. They don't have enough labor. So they decided to take new workers from China. And they're arriving while we are there. So I decided to focus on that aspect. So all of a sudden, this very small oyster factory become a microcosmos of observing the globalization at play. You see how globalization works, what happens. So yeah, oftentimes you are focusing on a very, very small area, but you see something larger. That's how I try to achieve, what I try to achieve. And number 7, don't set up a theme or goal before editing. And the same thing applies to editing process. When I make document, when I'm shooting, I try not to set up a theme or goal. But in the editing too, I try not to do that. You know, you are tempted to do that because you want to know the result of your own work. You feel desire, I mean, to know that. But I no matter how tempting it is, I try to make myself open to whatever the discoveries you haven't made yet. So my editing process is very simple. When I shoot, when I'm done with shooting, I review all the footage. For example, theater 1 and 2, I shot over 307 hours. I look at the footage, all of them in real time, and I transcribe everything. And it took me 6 months to transcribe everything. And I cannot outsource it, because then it doesn't really it doesn't really serve the purpose. I need to look at the footage and observe, right? So I need to do it myself. But then when you see the whole thing, you have some favorite scenes, right? That scene was very, very interesting. This scene is not very interesting. You have some preferences. So I start editing what was interesting. So I start editing my favorite scenes. Doesn't have to be chronological, you know. It could be the last thing I shot. Actually, campaign 2, I started editing from the last shot because the last shot was my favorite shot. Anyway, if you build your favorite scenes one by one, you end up having many scenes which are interesting to you, right? So, and if you feel, maybe these are the enough material, then you put them together in one sequence. And that's the first cut, which is like first draft when you write research papers. So this first cut is usually very disappointing. And you hate yourself. Why did I spend so much time making this shit? Because it looks so crappy. What's interesting is each scene is interesting to you. But when you put them together in a random order, almost random order, it's totally doesn't make any sense. It looks so uninteresting. So, but I know this happens in the first cut. I know it from my experience. So I do not abandon the project and keep going. I shuffle around the editing. Like I usually use post-it. I write every scene and put them on the wall and shuffle the scenes around. And you find connections or discoveries, like, this scene and this scene should, if you put them together, it makes sense. Or this scene and this scene, if you put them far apart, it's much more interesting. You make discoveries. And you also find new things by doing that. So that's what I do in the editing. It takes forever. For theater 1 and 2, it took me 2 years to figure out the 5 hours and 42 minutes film. And campaign and mental, it took me 10 months. But sometimes I have exceptions, like Peace, it took me 4 days to find the right order, which is very unusual, but sometimes it happens. That's the process of editing. You gradually find out about what is the theme of this film from your material. You don't have a theme first and then get the material to prove your theme. It's the opposite. You find something interesting, and oh wow, actually this film is about that. That's the order of finding out. That's the most more organic and natural way, I believe, because theme is just a concept, but you're not listening to, well, you're not really looking at the reality. You have more direct, you are in touch with the reality if you start with what you shot. And then theme comes later. That's how I believe. And number eight, as I explained, no narration, no title or music. That's a rule. And number nine, use long takes rather than short takes. As I said, I want the audience to observe, right? So in order for the audience to be able to observe what's going on in the film, I need to kind of leave some room, enough room. If you chop up shots like, you know, music video, it's impossible for you to observe. It's almost like, yeah. So that's why all the propaganda films are very fast cut. Doesn't give you, you know, enough space to think about what you see. So I try to make the opposite of propaganda films. I want the audience to come up with a different feeling or different opinions, because, yeah, film is usually have multiple meanings, or it's open to many different interpretations, and that's the nature of film. So I want to use that characteristic as much as possible. So yeah, my film tend to be longer than shorter, which is not very good commercially, especially in the United States. If you go more than 90 minutes, your film is too long. I get that reaction all the time. But I think it's not a, sometimes it's necessary to take a look at the reality long enough to understand something. But some films are short. My film, shortest film is about 75 minutes. Its piece is only 75 minutes. And I felt it was enough time for this film. But some films like Theater 1 and 2, I needed 5 hours and 42 minutes. And it's natural, right? I mean some books are thicker, right? And some books are shorter. So yeah, 90 minutes is a commercial reason, like, I mean, for the movie theaters. And of course, commercial aspect is very important for a filmmaker to survive, but at the same time, I consider myself more like an artist. So for the sake of art, sometimes you just have to kind of sacrifice for commercial success. But actually, Theater 1 and 2 did very well in Japan. Some people even skipped their work to come to come to see it. They took a day off to see the film, which is unusual, I think, but that happened, yeah. And pay for the production yourself. You are probably beginning to wonder how I pay for the film. If you don't have any script or synopsis even before you shoot, how do you propose it? You can't. I mean, I don't even know what kind of film I'm making. How can I propose it to anybody? It's impossible. So basically, I pay for the production myself. And after the film is complete, I show it to many distributors, and if they like it, they take it, and we do commercial release. And I get back the box office, and also like DVDs or TV or whatever the income I get from the film. And I use the money for my living, and also I use the money to make my next films. That's the cycle I've been doing since 2005. So far 10 years, it's been working. And I'm surviving still. I don't know how much longer I could survive like that, but so far I don't have to rely on any outside sources. Although I occasionally receive grants, which doesn't tell me what to do. But I was so scared to take grants because I had a pretty bad experience dealing with TV stations. They always change your edit. Like, I mean, they have the final decision making power. So I can only make suggestions, and they always change the film as they wish. And I was very frustrated. So when I was offered a grant for the first time, I was like, who has the edit control? Who has the rights to edit? And if I don't have the rights to edit, I wouldn't accept your grant. And she was like, what the hell are you talking about? I was so protective. But fortunately, many grants do not really tell you what to do. So, I receive grants. These are the 10 commandments I make. But the method I'm doing is not really, I didn't come up with from scratch. I owe it to the tradition of direct cinema. I like my direct influence is Frederick Wiseman. He's a great filmmaker, master documentarian, and also I love D.A. Pennebaker or Messrs. Brothers. They are my like heroes and also my role model. Although they don't really talk about their method in an opening way, I'm sure we take very similar approach because here and there I hear interviews and I was right, you know. For example, Frederick Wiseman was asked about how he made domestic violence by an interviewer, and the interviewer asked him, how much did you know about domestic violence before you shot domestic violence? And he said, virtually none. So, see, yeah, he didn't know anything about it. That's why he made such an exciting film. So, yeah, gradually I find out, my approach is probably very similar to what they've been doing. I'd like to show you a clip of Campaign, my first film. It's the first shot of first scene of Campaign, and in this film, I followed my classmate from Tokyo University, and because he was running for a vacant seat in Kawasaki City Council. And I call him classmate, but he is much older than me. Why did I focus him? Because he's running from this LDP, which is very conservative party. It's like a Republican party for Americans. It's supposed to represent like conservative value, traditional value of Japan. But this guy, I know him from college, he's very bohemian type of guy. He's not a traditional guy. We were classmates, but he's much older than me because he failed to enter the university like 5 times. So it's called goro in Japanese. And he never shows up in classes. I've never seen him in a class. Only in drinking parties, and he's there. and because he never shows up in classes, he failed to move up to the next grade like 3 times. So in the graduation album, he appeared like 3 times in a row. Like, I mean, he always takes pictures, but he failed to graduate 3 times. And And after he graduated, finally, like after 7 years, he started selling stamps. He started selling stamps and coins, and he had no political background. And he was selling stamps and coins, and he met his wife on the internet. And their honeymoon destination was to North Korea. And he's a very unusual type of guy. So why the hell LDP is picking him as a candidate? It's like a Donald Trump. And how can he do that? I mean, how can they do that? So that was my burning question. So when I heard he was running for a seat, I have to shoot it. I have to see what happens. So that's the film's premise. And I'll show you the clip. And obviously, this is the very first time I shot his speech on the street. He said, I'm going to make a speech on the street. And probably it was the first day of shooting. So I've never seen him making any speech. So I just decided to follow him. And that this is what I saw. So I'd like you to kind of observe, right? I'd like you to observe what's happening. And please have in your mind some points. I'd like you to observe it from certain angles. One is that how long is each shot without any cutting? How did I construct the scene? Another point is how I was moving around with the camera position, meaning like where in relation to the subject, where am I? And also how did I move the camera? Panning or was zooming? And those points I'd like you to observe and see the first clip, which is about 5 minutes, I believe. Okay. Any questions so far? Are you guys okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
こんばんは、山内和彦です。よろしくお願いします。 自民党の山内和彦です。お仕事帰り、お疲れ様です。自民党川崎支援改革推進チームの山内和彦でございます。私、山内和彦は、この川崎の市政において、小泉改革を実践してまいります。
私山内和彦、皆様とともにこの川崎で改革を進めてまいります。どうか引き続き私山内和彦と小泉自民党の進める改革に引き続いて大きな皆様のご支援を賜りますようお願い申し上げます。お騒がせし申し訳ございません。小泉自民党の山内和彦でございます。お勤め帰りお疲れ様です。自民党川崎支店山内和彦です。
こんばんは、山内和彦です。お疲れ様です。改革取り組んでまいります。よろしくお願いします。こんばんは、山内です。改革取り組んでまいります。よろしくお願いします。
ご通行中の皆様こんばんは。小泉自民党山内和彦でございます。
こんばんは。
私山内和彦は皆様と共にこの川崎の地で改革取り組んでまいります。今国で進められております小泉改革、今地方でも改革は待ったなしです。しかしまだ改革には反対する勢力、抵抗する勢力たくさんいます。現在私たちが取り組まなければならない改革、まずは行財政改革です。国から地方へ、そして官から民へお金の流れを変えることで、私たち自民党改革派自民党は小さな政府を実現いたします。この小さな政府というのは無駄を省いた、そういった政府のことです。まだまだ行政には無駄がたくさんあります。私山内和彦は皆さんと共にこの川崎で改革に取り組んでまいります。
こんばんは、山内です。よろしくお願いします。こんばんは、山内和彦です。改革取り組んでまいります。お疲れ様です。こんばんは、山内です。よろしくお願いします。
こんばんは、山内和彦です。
こんばんは、山内です。よろしくお願いします。
ご通行中の皆様こんばんは。
こんばんは、山内です。お疲れ様です。お疲れ様です。頑張ってまいります。
こんばんは、山内です。
はい、お父さんお母さんによろしく。はい、ダメですね。4 5 4 4勉強頑張って
ご通行中の皆様こんばんは。
お疲れ様です。お疲れ様です。自民党川崎支店改革推進チームの山内和彦でございます。先般の衆議院選挙では皆様の改革への大きなご支援のおかげで、小泉自民党の進める改革推進チーム大躍進いたしました。これは皆様一人一人の大勝利です。選挙によって政治が変わります。そして国も変わります。そしてこの川崎も選挙によって変わるのです。私山内和彦、改革をブレーキかける、改革にストップをかける勢力は許しません。皆様と共にこの改革に反対する勢力とは戦ってまいります。どうか私山内和彦に引き続き皆様の大きなご支援を賜りますよう、そして小泉自民党の進める改革に大きなご支援をよろしくお願い申し上げます。
Yeah, so so what was your observation? Like any observations? Yeah.
It was so realistic. It was like you could have been anyone on that street or by that subway exit, just you know. Oh, okay, this politician, like, it's like you could have been someone walking right past him, or you could have been someone just observing him from a distance.
Right.
It's like you had no relation, like, I would never have guessed that you actually knew him personally.
Okay, so. good. Yeah.
There was, like, maybe one or two cuts, like, in total, and the whole thing is just, like, basically following him, like, around. It's like you're almost, like, there in the scene with him, and it's, like, basically, like, the first-person shot of, like, you just, like, walking around.
Right. Yeah, first shot, is about 4 minutes and 30 seconds. The it's a very long, continuous shot. I did it because this is the first shot of the observational film series. I thought I was planning to make, you know, observational film series. So I had to kind of tell the audience my attitude towards filmmaking. I thought I have to kind of, like, it's like a letter to the challenge letter, like you challenge. How do you say it? some sort of a statement.
Provocative message.
Yeah, provocative message. It's a message to the
contract.
Yeah. Okay.
Throw down. The gauntlet.
Yeah. Whatever. Like, you know, this is the way I present my films. That's the kind of like an introduction to my series. So, yeah, I decided to use a long shot, a long take. And also, I thought it was, it gives you, later on, there will be a talk about, like, he doesn't really talk about policies, and he repeats his names and his party. And that's the strategy he does. But in this shot, you see how often he makes, like, he mentions his name and also his political party, and that's a real time. So there's no cheating. If I cut them, you know, down, then I can manipulate, and I can be suspected that I was only connecting whatever, I mean, arbitrary shots. But with this shot, you can't really cheat it. Yeah.
Do you use extra lighting?
No lighting at all. Yeah, it's available light. Yeah.
Just like a question on him: does he actually even believe what he's saying, or is it just like for show?
I have no idea. I've never asked. Anybody else? Any observations?
Well, yeah. There is a moment where there's a small, very short cut. It's very quick. Where there's a, I guess there's like a sort of reverse shot into these people coming out of the
right.
of the train station. I guess.
Right.
It seemed to me that it's very streamlined. You know, like if you're not somewhere where you asked us to be careful about what cuts are there or are there not. Maybe you could just, maybe someone would not be able to notice it. And I was wondering, based on your own approach to filmmaking, why would you make such a choice? What is the reason of having this very long take, as you were saying?
Mm-hmm.
It's very immersive.
Mm-hmm.
You're moving around.
Right.
We're moving around with you. And why all of a sudden there's like this little...
Right, right.
And then
yeah, I think it creates rhythm, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and actually that's the how I construct the whole film. I use long shots, but also I use short shots too. So it creates kind of rhythm, yeah.
Yeah, one thing I noticed is, you know, one of the criticisms of the observational mode or direct cinema is that it kind of gives you a sense of realism, but mm-hmm. there is a controlling person, and there's
right.
a camera,
right.
and there is selection and all
right.
that, right? What I found really interesting about this was I was very aware of your movements.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you were trying to figure out, I mean,
right.
should I follow this person?
Right.
And a couple times I was like, I might go that way, I might not go that way,
right?
Instead of just kind of like a camera.
That's
stand,
right.
A tripod.
Right.
You know, I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's very subjective, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Subjective and objective.
Yes.
That's what you started off with.
Yes, yeah. It's very subjective. You know, I don't pretend I'm making something objective. It's impossible. You know, when you aim your camera to somebody, you made a choice. That's already subjective. And also, how do I move my camera? Everything is subjective. You're making constant choice. And also, how do I position? When do I roll the camera? When do I stop it? Everything is subjective. So even if it's observational film, it's subjective film. And that's the, actually. I even have a title card because it's very important. And yeah, and I also tried to find out what's going on. As I said, this was my first time of seeing him making any speech in public. So I had no idea what kind of speech he's making and how people would respond. So first, I was just observing while rolling the camera. And then I noticed when I shot him making speech and then pan, nobody was listening. That was what I noticed. And then, you know, yeah, obviously people are not very, very interested in what he's talking about. That's what I found out. So then I started trying to figure out how do I convey my finding, my discovery here. And I came up with the last shot of zooming from, I moved all the way up to the end of the station and got a gradual zoom out to stress the fact nobody's listening, right? So it's not only observation, but also you need to make interpretation, like or translation to the visual language. That's the point. But what you don't want to forget about is that I had no idea what kind of scene I was going to make beforehand. It was according to my discovery that I created the last shot. That's different, right? If I had a preconception, okay, I have to shoot a scene where nobody's listening, and then go in. The result is probably different. Well, usually, if I had a preconception, probably I would have preconceived like people are listening because it's a political speech. I mean, that's the regular way of thinking, right? So I would probably, if I wrote the script saying people are listening to what he's saying, then I would probably go out and shoot. And even if nobody's listening, I try to look for somebody who's listening and then and take a shot of somebody, maybe smoking cigarette. But if you have a shot of like shot like that and combine them together in the editing room, you can create a scene where Yamauchi is making a scene, making a speech, and somebody's listening, smoking cigarette. You can do that. But I don't want to do that. That's the concept of observational filmmaking. In this film, in this scene, the discovery was nobody was listening. So I tried to convey that. Yeah.
Along those lines, I had a more general question about your process.
Yeah.
I think it's really fascinating how you talk about that this is a discovery and you don't have a preconceived theme or
right.
What it's going to be. So I wonder, in general, how do you choose your subject matter? Mm-hmm.
It depends on the subject, but I usually have like about 20 items on my list, like what are my interests, candidates, subject candidates. Sometimes I get to know somebody who is on the list, so whatever I encounter, I start filming. For example, Oyster Factory movie, I had fishermen on my list for such a long time. And then I got to know fishermen when I was on vacation in a town where we take a vacation. There were many fishermen in front of our house. So we got to know each other, and they gave me permission. So yeah, first I have some interests, and then sometimes just come to you. But it depends on the film, but yeah. You had a question?
I was wondering, so you have these interests and these candidates, do you ever start shooting things and then not work out?
Right, that's possible.
Yeah, there's some failed.
Sure, sure. But I've never failed before.
I mean, not yet.
Not yet. I mean, I could, but you know, but I think, you know, the point is you need to kind of accept the possibility of failing. Yeah, you and what's important is that's why it's important to be independent as a financially too. If you take somebody's money and do it, and it didn't work out, doesn't really, it's irresponsible, right? But if you're using your own money, it's different. So, yeah, I need to be very independent, yeah. But I have a belief. It's almost impossible to fail, because if you look close enough, somebody or some group of people, you always find something interesting. It's a matter of observing. It's a matter of attentiveness. Like if you're determined to look and listen, nobody in this world is not interesting. Everybody has some interesting thing. So it's a matter of discovery. So I have a feeling that I would never fail. I could be wrong. Yeah.
Question: are you ever impulsive about your subjects? Like, okay, well, you found that your classmate was going to be running a campaign.
Yeah.
Did you just decide, okay, that would be a cool idea,
right,
and just jump at the opportunity?
Yeah,
well?
Yeah, impulsive.
Yeah.
Actually, when I shot campaign, I was preparing to go to Japan to shoot Mental. And I already got my camera, and I was packing my suitcase, and I learned the fact that he was running for office through a mutual friend. And my departure to Japan was only 5 days away. And I made a phone call to Yama-san, and he said, okay, please shoot it. So I decided to shoot it. So from the time I knew that he was running for a seat until I started shooting, I had about a week. So it was really an impulsive thing, actually. And then I shot Mental. I started shooting Mental right after I was done with Yama-san's shoot. I was only shooting 12 days with Yama-san, and after I'm done with shooting, I moved to Okayama and started shooting Mental. So, yeah.
How long did it take to shoot Mental?
Hmm?
How long did it take to shoot Mental?
Like Mental, it was over 2 years period of time. Yeah. Yeah.
So, back to the failure question. it seems that one of the ways you hedge against failure is by shooting a lot. And you're shooting many hours.
Mm.
And then you have faith within those many, many hours that you will find enough interesting material to make an interesting film. So my question is, how do you know when you've shot enough?
Ah. I don't know, but I have an instinct, like, maybe I have enough. I could be wrong, but I've never been wrong about that. So I've never gone back to shoot more. I've never done that before. So maybe it's a professional instinct. When I was making documentaries for TV, I've made 50 programs, I guess. 55-0. So it was a lot of training. Especially, it gave me a lot of training when I was making a weekly series called New Yorkers. We pick one New Yorker every week and do a day and life of. It's a 20-minute mini documentary, and I was one of the directors. And we had four directors, which means I need to come up with one show every month. Meaning, first week I'm researching and writing synopsis, and I have meeting with subject, and I get approval from the producer. Second week, I'm shooting. Third week, I'm editing. Fourth week, I'm writing narration, putting music, finishing up. And fifth week, I'm already doing the next show. And I did it for 3 years. So it was like crash course of documentary filmmaking. I didn't know anything about documentary filmmaking, but by doing that, I learned it like by my like body. Like it's like a, it's engraved in my body, I think. Yeah.
Have you ever considered for the observational film shooting a subject like in America or any other country?
Yeah, sure.
Or is it only like Japanese like subjects?
No. It kind of, it became, yeah, it happened to be Japanese subjects. I mean, all of my films so far, but I don't really limit myself. But I always want to put some social context to the characters. So I need to know about the society well enough. So probably I'm qualified to make Japanese subjects and also maybe American subjects, but that's all. I also need to speak the language too, because I need to respond to whatever they're talking about. So, yeah. So, but I'm open to American subjects. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Anything else? Yeah. But anyway, yeah. To make discoveries is important. And also, observational film is the art of coincidence. you need to rely on your coincidence, but usually something strange happens when you roll in the camera. I don't know why, but it happens. Maybe we just overlook in the daily lives, you know, like because we are rolling, you are aware, but in the daily lives, you are not aware because it's just daily life. Do we have time? I see. Yeah. How many times? Okay. I was going to show a mental clip, but it's I don't have. Yeah. But anyway, my observation of film is more like a participant observation. I said it's a subjective film, and I as a filmmaker also become a subject of observation too. Also, when you are shooting a film, and sometimes subjects are doing what they're doing only because I'm there and shooting the film. So you can only capture whatever the reality that's affected by my presence. So you cannot be just a distant person, and you cannot have nothing to do with the characters. You are always capturing something that's changed because of my presence. So yeah, my observation of films are always participant observation. I'm part of the reality. I'm observing the reality, which includes me. And yeah. Any other questions or comments? Yeah.
I have a question about. Let me try to phrase this well. I really liked at the beginning when you were saying that part of your work is to try to get in touch with reality,
right?
And there's all these restrictions that you have, starting from like having a camera to make a documentary.
Mm.
There's something that mediates between you and that reality.
That's
right.
Right?
And as you were talking of your creative process, it reminded me a lot of Pedro Costa's process,
yeah.
Which has many similarities, many differences as well, of course. But I wanted to ask you. So he also makes really long takes. He has
That's
a lot
right.
of footage,
right.
and his work I think is more collective, but still it's like this out of a mass of material trying to make a film that tries to relate or to touch reality.
Right.
But he himself, he doesn't see his movies as documentaries. He says that he is making fiction, even though it's about
real
people.
Right.
And I was wondering how will you position yourself in this boundary between fiction and nonfiction, or between how some other directors like Costa does his own films and your own films that are I haven't had the chance to see them and
right.
I really want to. That I guess they also must coastal hover between these limits between the fiction and the nonfiction, the subjective
That's right.
and the objective.
That's right.
Et cetera.
Right. Well, I think it's useful to make distinction between documentary and fiction, although the boundary is very, very blurry. It's like you cannot really separate clear cut, because you are aiming your camera to the reality, but it's already a fictional thing. It's in the frame, and also you are constructing it in the editing room, and it's highly manipulative process. So what you come up with is a film, which is also fictitious. Although you are aiming your camera to the real people, it's also fictitious. The time which is flowing in the film is also fictitious. It's condensed, right? So the boundary between documentary and fiction is like there is no boundary, but it's more like a gradation. Like it's always in the middle, and within the film also it goes like this, like shifting all the time, fictitious, more documentary, fictitious, documentary. It's like always like this movement within one film or within one scene. It kind of changes gradually. But one thing, the only thing that separates documentary from fiction is the responsibility to the subjects. Because the documentary is supposed to be there. We have a premise that these people are real. So what they're talking about is, what they do on camera is something they do. For example, if you are making a fiction film and the actor is playing this villain, and no matter how bad this villain is, actor won't be accused of his acts because people know it's a fiction. But in the documentary, somebody is acting like a villain and depicted as a villain. This guy will take the heat, right? Because there is a premise. He is a real guy and that's what he's doing. So as a filmmaker, you need to take that into consideration. We are manipulating their images and present in a certain way, meaning we need to be responsible for that person's image. I really felt that when I was making Mental, because, for example, one of the subjects, she kind of confessed to me while I was rolling the camera that when she had a baby, first baby, she had no support of everybody, and she had a mental illness as well, and she was so overwhelmed that she put her hand into her baby's mouth, and he ended up dying, and she was also arrested because of that. And she seemed to have not confessed the story to anybody else, almost. So it was almost like the first time to talk about it, and it was for the camera. So I had to think so many times before I should use it or not. Of course she agreed to be on the camera, but should I use it?
Actually, that was a clip I was going to show it, but it's 16 minute long, so I can't do it. But should I use it or not? And I decided to use it, but I felt a tremendous responsibility to her life, especially because she was happy that she was shot. But gradually, when the film was, you know, going to release in cinemas in their region, she started to become very nervous, and she said she wants to commit suicide on the day of the release of the film. And I can't say, you know, if she commits suicide because of the film, I can't say I'm not responsible. So I seriously thought about canceling the film, but before that, I went to see her and talk to her, and she became kind of relaxed because I went there and you know, listened to her, and also other people in the clinic or the doctor also spoke with her, and she became more and more relaxed, and finally she gave me a letter to read to the audience, and she accepted the fact that it's going to be released in her region, and she's still fine now. We make communications all the time through Facebook. We are Facebook friends, and but I need to be responsible, you know. I need to be kind of, I feel responsible of showing her image and story out in public. And this you never have to deal with if you're a fiction filmmaker. You don't have to take care of the actor's life. I mean, you don't have to feel responsible about the actor's life, you know, forever. But in the documentary, I feel obligation or responsibility. So that's the main difference, I think. Yeah.
Kind of a talk, I'm actually very curious about sort of the relationship between your notion of observation film versus the direct cinema, which you say you draw a lot of inspiration from, because with the very notion of observation, that notion already deny any subjectivity, right? There's talking about camera on the wall. So direct cinema cannot be subjective because there's a very notion of directness. But by calling observation film, obviously it's a subjective because there's someone observing, right? By calling it observational, you emphasize the subjective part of it. And also you talk about the filming and talk about how filming is to discover something interesting, which I think also something maybe to do with the apparatus of cinema or the camera, excuse me, because I Susan Sontar described in photography, but filming a photograph isn't making events, making something interesting out
That's
of
right.
non-interesting. So you always emphasizing both the subject part of observation and also the subject part of the camera, even the camera itself, even as automatic machine, can make some subjective selection of something interesting out of the non-interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, you seem to be emphasizing this very selective notion of filming seems to be a great departure from direct cinema. So I'm just curious about sort of the genealogical position of what you think of both conceptual and the genealogical position between your observation film versus direct cinema, because you obviously said you're influenced by them.
Right.
How you see yourself as both influenced by them but also a great departure from them.
Right. Well, I'm not a scholar, so I don't really study how observational films are made, and also I mean, direct cinema is made, and also I don't really know each filmmaker of direct cinema think about their own stance about objectivity or participation of the filmmaker. I don't know about that, but my starting point, I consider myself more like an artist. So for me, my artistic endeavor started with direct cinema. It's a starting point. And but I didn't want to call my films direct cinema because direct cinema has been around since the 60s. And it has a certain, I don't know, it's already an established idea, I think.
And my film probably will slip away. I knew it, you know, because I'm a different person. And I'm not interested in succeeding direct cinema as it was. It's like a traditional dance or traditional ritual. I mean, I'm not a successor. I'm an artist. So I wanted to have a different name for that. So I'm sure it's already different. I mean, yeah, it's like you said, it's a departure. But still, it's like a direct cinema is a mother or a father, and I'm a kid. But kid is not necessarily the same as parents, but they share some genes, right? So I consider myself as more like a children, or one of the kids of the direct cinema, maybe. It fits to my feeling, I think. Did I answer your question?
Okay. Let me take a break here.
Yeah.
So it's 12:30, so let's take a break here. 10 minutes, there's food in the back if you'd like to get some food. And then in about 10 minutes, let's continue the conversation.
Yeah.
Also, I want to announce that Director Soda's films, they're all in the Hillman Library in the Stark Media Center, so if you are interested in them, you didn't get to see Mental last night, you can get it from the library.
Also, I'm donating these books I wrote to the library, so
thank you.
It's
thank
in
you.
Japanese, though.
Good practice, though.
Thank you so much. It's great to meet you.
Yeah.
I'm a writer by passion, so this is actually really useful to me.
Oh, good, good.
I'm just curious, can we buy your movies?
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
Okay, where?
It's on Vimeo.
Charles.
There.
If you go to...
Sorry.
It's my name, KazuhiroSoda.com.
Mm-hmm.
Then it has a link to the online purchase.
Actually, can I have your autograph?
Oh, of course. Oops.
Sorry.
I'm too strong.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah, I yours.
Can I take a picture?
I just speak like a picture.
Okay. Oh, I take a picture of you together.
Thank you so much.
You've been here a while.
Oh, I don't know what happened.
Oh, yes. Yes. I'm a filmmaker.
Blurry.
Thank you so much.
So I want to introduce you to Edith. Edith is a documentary.
Benin, West Africa.
Yes.
But I've been living in France for many years. Maybe just came here.
Did you
watch the film? I saw you were in Berlin.
Oh yeah.
Yes. I mean, I actually film in Berlin actually. So and I've been many times in Berlin film festival.
Right.
And I screened one of my films.
Absolutely no opportunity.
Yes, that's me.
I sent her like at least 3 or 4 emails.
Oh, good.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. No, you can.
So the money.
Thank you.
Okay.
My name is David.
David.
Yeah, I'm from Colombia, so
oh,
my English.
No. Excuse my English.
I'm just a little bit curious. I went yesterday to see Mental.
Right.
And I remember those little images between the interviews you had, like the painting leaves
right.
and the swan.
Right.
So I didn't understand I don't know, the purpose of those images.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I just wanted to know.
Well, there are two purposes. Okay. One is to create rhythm. When you hear a very heavy story, you need some time to digest.
Yeah, yeah.
So in between scenes serve that purpose as well.
Okay.
Also, I want to show the surroundings or context of the character. What kind of town they are living, what kind of surroundings they have. Also, hopefully, these in-between images and main scenes, when they put together, it can create some sort of chemical reactions. For example, the bird, beautiful swan, and story of somebody else. When you put them together, you feel something.
Right? Okay. Yes. I was a little bit afraid when you showed those girls, and after that, it was the interview of that man who said that he was afraid to commit a crime with something. It was like shocking to me.
Yeah.
So that,
Right.
Thank
you. Actually,
thank you.
So much. Thank you very much.
New York. So when you're in the editing phase, what's your schedule like daily? Like, do you give yourself a quota? Like, how much you have to edit? Like, do you give yourself weekends? Like, what's that?
I'm too lazy to do that. It's always tough to start the editing, but my approach is usually I try to start only 15 minutes. Okay. I need to focus 15 minutes from now on. Then I start editing. Then, without knowing it, I'm editing for 1 hour. That's how I get into the project. And once you get into the project and you become up to speed, you feel anxious to edit more and more. So that's how I trick myself. And so sometimes I edit like 10 hours a day. Sometimes I only do like one hour or even 15 minutes. It's important to use bits and small time.
Thank you so much.
Oh,
bye-bye.
Thank you.
I'm up to those. I'm sorry.
Okay.
So nice to see you. That was great.
Yeah, nice. And I want to check out your gallery.
Do you swing by? Yeah, it'll be open on the day today.
Okay.
Yeah, you can jump in.
Okay.
And Rick will be by later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Would you be willing to take a...
So I just want to, very briefly... This is Mila. She's a graduate student. She's interested in writing an article on you.
Okay.
Yes, so it's... And I'll take a job right now.
Okay.
I figured... my focus is with solo documentaries, as it's called, and I'm writing my dissertation on immigrant focus. Migration all over the world.
I'm not
because it is German studies, and what I've discovered over the past 15, 16 years or so,
just looking
at a lot of Europe, which is actually embedded on it.
and we want to take a picture of that.
Yeah, the observations attempting to place the camera. There is a choice. You can't have a big brother camera watching everybody all the time, you know. But in that, there is a desire to really try and capture something in reality that we don't like to take. And that in itself is challenging for fiction and nonfiction. So really, they came out of the dichotomy. So that's a little bit of my background. However, I would like to focus solely on you and your work and place you within sort of this globalized, I think, documentary. Is that something that you would be interested in? Okay, so it would be a point up and coming. An artistry, scholarly journal, or maybe another film journal. I'm not sure. I have to be interested. The art history one is okay with it. They told me to record it. Okay, great. Do you have an email address?
Sure.
And, okay, great. So I'll be in touch that way.
Yep.
Perfect. Okay, great. Thank you very much.
And what's the fact that you might be interested to you as opposed to if you're doing the immigrant?
Yes, absolutely. I made a note of that. When you mentioned China is coming on November 9th. Actually, absolutely. So it really details like that where we noticed that you said part of the whole, actually. There's a whole approach in building. So, okay, so is it, you said you just finished that? So it's edited? And,
It's edited and it's world premiere at the Locarno.
Okay,
a few weeks ago, and now it's traveling.
Would I be able to? How would I go and see?
Yeah, I can get you.
Okay, all right. Yeah, that would just be for me, you know, for just for my purposes, right?
Okay. So if you can give me email.
Absolutely, I'll email you. Yes, I'll be the one to email from
Okay.
It's a pleasure. Thank you so much. Mila. Yes, actually, my full name is Ludmila. Yeah, but Mila is better. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to call everyone back together.
All right,
if we could reconvene until 1 o'clock and continue the discussion.
Thank you. It was nice to meet you. I have to go
Thank
teach.
You. Okay.
The questions.
Okay. Yeah. Let's do it casually, because we are all eating.
I have a question. And this kind of comes up partly because obviously you observing the location deeply is a part of your practice, and also because I noticed in Mental last night that you use some nature cutaways.
Right.
In between scenes, right? Like, there's a beautiful heron that flies off, and there's a the flock of birds that the sort of goes into flight.
Right.
Used as kind of interludes, I guess you would say. But there's also this wonderful recurring image of a leaf that seems to be stuck in a spider web.
Right. Right.
That kind of is twirling around, which. Seems very analogous to the situation people find themselves in the film, which is wonderful.
Mm.
And I'm just wondering, how much of that do you plan for in the shooting? I mean, do you say I need a couple of beautiful natural features just in case, or
how does that work into your working process?
When I'm shooting the main scenes, so-called main scenes, I feel like I'm looking at it like from using a magnifying glasses. Like I'm really concentrating on very small area or something. I'm really looking closely. And after a while, I feel kind of like suffocated. Like, you know, I want to see a larger world, and I put them in a context. Like what kind of town they are living, or what kind of environment their lives in it. When I feel like doing that, I take out the camera on the street with a tripod and shoot whatever that kind of interests me. And it's often kind of related to what I saw in the main scenes. When you walk down the street, or if you're in the nature, you see something that interests me, because my interest is kind of affected by the main actions. So I shoot a lot of that, actually. And then in the editing, I try to figure out what's best to go with. And obviously the leaf is something I noticed when I was shooting, and it's almost metaphorical of the whole situation or there. So yeah, I decided to shoot it several times in different times of the day to show that it was there forever. I mean, not just one time, but you know, yeah. And I also want to, for the audience too, I need to create rhythm. Like when the audience is watching the main scene, like some heavy stories, then they need some time to digest it. So I would put those, you know, in between scenes to give them a time to digest it, and hopefully this will also put the characters in the context, larger context, and also I want something like a chemical reaction could happen in between the scenes and this. In between scenes, especially, I felt that when I made piece, if you look at the piece, it kind of went to the next level for me. These are not just sceneries, but it kind of creates something more metaphorical. So, yeah.
And kind of following up with this question. What would you say about this other process of the observational film? As you've been talking throughout this hour, it seems that the process of observing with the camera is I don't know if you would say as important, or at least there's two dynamics going on. One is the actual observation, but also there's a lot happening in the editing room and when you're shuffling your
right.
Post-its. And what would you say about that process and as observational film, is shuffling coincidence? I don't know if you could tell a little bit more about that part.
You mean
is
in the editing?
Is it observational to edit?
Yeah, I think so. Because in the editing room, you get to observe more, actually. When you are shooting, it happens only once, and you also operate in the camera, so you have to care about many things like angle, aperture, focus. Everything is manual, and also camera movement, make it still, so many things. So you often overlook something important when you're shooting, but in the editing, you have the advantage to be able to look over and over and over again. So actually, power of observation is more important in the editing room. You have the privilege, you have the advantage to see it so many times. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay. I guess my question sort of ties in with the issue of your, not an issue, the question or the role you take as a participant in the process.
Yeah.
I, from watching Mental last night, there was very little of you talking.
Mm.
This was not you asking questions
right.
and answering.
Right.
Is that something that you're editing out questions, or is really this, I mean, how much in the actual shooting process are you prompting them, and how much are your subjects just, you're freely observing?
I prompt my questions only when I have burning questions. I basically do not really ask any questions. But when they start talking to me, I react and record my reaction. And actually, when I made Mental, I didn't have that concept yet. I thought I was invisible. I mean, I could be invisible and I could be distant. And that's what I did with the campaign. With the campaign, I was much more heavily influenced by Frederick Wiseman and the direct cinema tradition. So I wanted to be invisible. But with Mental, when I was shooting, patients started talking to me. And some patients even said like a cut, like, you know, cut. And I was kind of first, it's interesting, but maybe I won't be able to use it. I mean, that's how I thought. But then in the editing, those were the scenes which were the most, I mean, the strongest. So if my method prevents me of using the strongest moments in the film, what's the method is for? Method is the purpose of the method is to create something interesting, right? So I realized, you know, my method or concept was wrong. So that's how I came up with the idea of participant observation. So I should include myself. But at the same time, I don't want to be manipulative of the situation. So I do not really actively try to get something out of something. Somebody, and I'm actually pretty good at digging some questions out of somebody and get some great sound bites. I'm so trained to do that, and but I don't like doing that because I feel like a hunter. Like I try to get something I want from this person. And so sometimes basic rule is that I ask questions only when I have a burning question or they talk to me. And it's more like a conversation. So when I have elements which seem like an interview, I do not call it interview. I call it more like a conversation because that's what it is.
You know, I'll give you a chance to eat. This question will be slightly long.
Mm.
So I was struck by, you know, your 10 commandments for making documentary films, and the other things you said about responsibility, participant observation, and, you know, my own experience doing ethnographic fieldwork, you know, in religious studies. And that is that, you know, I think good academic work, also, you do not know the point in advance. You do not know what you're going to find.
Mm.
You do not have an argument before you start. You go out there, you talk to people, you try to learn what's going on. And then you look at your notes and something emerges. So my question is, you know, I know you've written, you know, 5 books.
Mm.
and I know you've written a lot for the media in different ways. Do you find any parallels between the way you write and the way you make film?
I think so, because 10 commandments is also like it sounded like I had it from the very beginning, but didn't have it. It was a vague idea, and as I wrote books, I started to kind of like I started to realize, oh yeah, there are 10. And very recently, I started calling it 10 Commandments because it sounds catchy and funny. So it's, writing is also about discovery, right? I mean, when you know what to write before you start writing, you usually are writing something boring. Sometimes you have some ideas and then you think you have something to write about, but you don't know exactly. And as you write, you discover. And that's more exciting, I think. So yeah, it's a parallel. Very similar, I think, yeah. But words are different from images. That's the difference, yeah. Words have more like, their meanings are much more limited and narrower. Images doesn't necessarily have meanings, right? So the media is different, but approach is very similar.
Yeah, it's an interesting point about, you know, an image has a greater interpretive scope than a sentence.
Yeah. Anything else?
I was struck, if I may. You know, I was struck by, you know, when I watch your films, you use the word rhythm. And what I've experienced watching them is that, you know, part of that rhythm is very mood driven, it seems. And so you have scenes that where the mood is very light, and then you have scenes where the mood is very heavy. And then you have scenes where the mood is very serene, and then you have moods where it's very kind of lively and jumpy.
Right.
And you know, I wondered if you had any kind of method in terms of how to mix scenes that depict different moods.
Mm.
Because it really seemed that the rhythm of many of your scenes are mood driven, not just subject driven, but there's the moods between the scenes creates a real rhythm.
It's true, yeah. But I think the scene kind of dictates the mood,
Right, sure.
I didn't really create it. You know, it's more like I try to kind of capture the mood of the scene. But it's not something I created from scratch. So I just follow. It's kind of like it's almost like you are just digging the land to find something, like, let's say, Buddha statue. Like, it's there already. And I try to unearth it and then make it cleaner. So that's how I feel, actually, more like, yeah.
When you juxtaposition two different moods, like at the end of Mental, there's a very light scene followed by a very heavy scene.
Right.
I mean, is there some type of rhetorical strategy going on there that you're saying if you put these two very contrasting scenes together, this is what happens? When you're in the editing room, where really a lot of the creation is happening, do you really kind of what are you thinking when you're thinking about the different mood of scenes?
I think I'm trying to follow my instinct as a filmmaker. It's like probably when you're writing, for some reasons, like there are you also think about the rhythm and also the mood of the writing, right? Mm. And sometimes you feel right, mm. and sometimes you feel wrong.
Okay, so it's gut feel.
Yeah,
gut feel.
Yeah.
It's not,
and
you don't have a strategy.
Exactly, and you don't know why it feels right and it feels wrong, but there is some sort of I don't know feeling, mm-hmm. and yeah, that's how I constructed. Yeah.
I had a question about mental. You
yeah.
mentioned that it's
yeah.
a wonderful film, by the way. But,
thank you.
How you filmed over a 2-year period, and so does that affect sort of the observational cinema once you start developing relationships? Because you're talking about you're having these conversations with them, obviously seeing how their life is progressing. And I had a question about, would you try always to have the camera on, and then, you know, sometimes people feel more comfortable, like, oh, the camera's off, now I can really open up and share. And so how did that influence the final product?
Yeah, there are many things like that. For example, he never appears in the film because he refused to be in the film. Mm-hmm. But he, I don't know, for some reason he likes me, and he always come to the camera and sit next to me and tell me all kinds of stories, and it's so interesting. I always ask him, can I shoot that, many times, but no. So it's never in the film, but there are many patients like that.
Right. And even you were saying campaign was 14 days, so it seemed that would be much more related to kind of the direct cinema where you're just coming in and just uncovering, but over a 2-year period, even if it's not continuous filming, you're becoming more like the participant aspect
yeah.
of that. As
yeah.
It enlarges, and the observation seems maybe you are becoming such a bigger participant.
Yes, I'm a participant, yeah. Yeah. I mean, for them, I think I'm like a stranger, like in Japanese, ijin, like marebito, like somebody who's visiting, you know, from outside. And I'm rare, you know, I mean, you know, I'm a rare person for them, and for me they are rare person, but so I'm obviously, they are also observing me, mm-hmm. you know, what kind of person I am, and can I trust this guy, or
so did you end up getting better footage sort of later, or was the earlier stuff
I don't see any differences.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. I don't see it. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm. Well, that brings us to 1:00.
Okay.
So I think I'll let Director Soda eat. And thank you for coming and help me thank
Dr.
Thank
you very much.
Director Soda.